So maybe the basic starting point is, and this is, if you would now want to really describe the whole standard model as a with a causal fermion system. So you want to have, you need to want to have neutrinos, quarks, you want to have all the gauge interactions of the standard model. Then the starting point for the causal fermion system is always you have to say, what is the, how does the vacuum state look like? And the vacuum state looks is formed of such Dirac Cs as we just discussed. But now you have to take many of them, namely one for each type of particle. And then in the end, what this leads to is you have to take seven identical copies of Dirac Cs, in fact, of what we call sectors. Each sector contains three Dirac Cs to account for the three generations of elementary particles. So we take seven of such sectors, which are identical, and then there's an eighth one, which is different. This is the one which describes quarks, and it's different because there's a we have to assume that there's a left-right asymmetry. So the chiral symmetry is broken in this sector. Good, and then we have like these eight sectors in total. And then the starting point, this is if you want to get a connection to octonions, then the octonions also can be represented by 8×8 matrices. So they act naturally on these eight sectors. And then the question is, well, why eight? And do these algebraic structures of the octonions really reflect certain properties of the causal action and the causal Lagrangian and so on? And so this is something we discussed quite in detail. And then in the meantime, well, I also visited the Jinder once together with Jose Isidro in Valencia. And then they also came here last year in summer. I should say they will also be in October at this conference, which I mentioned earlier. So we want to discuss all this further. And the general goal is to understand, at least I mean from my perspective, to understand how all these algebraic structures like octonions and also, I mean, there are other like exceptional Jordan algebras and other algebraic structures, how they, first of all, how do they come into play if you describe these causal fermion systems? And in particular, how do they connect to the structure of this of the causal Lagrangian and the causal action principle?
Did I hear you say chirality, that you have an explanation for chirality?
Well, maybe explanation is not the right word, I would say. I mean, well, let's say, I mean, we to describe the vacuum, we work with Dirac particles, so in order to build up these Dirac Cs. And a Dirac particle always has a left and a right-handed component. So therefore, there is a chirality there already. And now we need to assume, this is really an input, I mean, there's no explanation for that right now, that,
I see.
The,
okay.
That this neutrino sector breaks the chiral symmetry. And but we don't have to be very specific. For example, one possibility is that one of the three neutrino generations appears only as a left-handed particle. There's no right-handed counterpart. But there are other possibilities as well. So we don't need to be very specific, but there must be some left-right asymmetry. And only if this is imposed, then we get the correct gauge groups of the standard model and the correct couplings and the mixing matrices and all of that.
So you get mass differences between the neutrinos? Because in order for there to be neutrino oscillations, you require mass differences, no?
Yeah, okay, yeah, exactly. So, I mean, the precise statement is that at least one of the neutrino generations must be massive, so they can't all be massless, and that there should be a left-right asymmetry. So this is all we need. And also, like a massive neutrinos are also needed in order to get so that the vacuum is a minimizer of the causal action. I mean, this is what I said at the beginning. I mean, we have this vacuum state should always be a solution of the physical equations. And if you just work only with massless neutrinos, this doesn't work. So somehow it's necessary that at least one of the neutrinos is massive. But as I said, I mean, we don't get, I mean, let's put it like that. I mean, if we suppose we do not put in a chiral symmetry, then we get different gauge groups, different couplings, and everything changes.
I see.
So in other words, the statement is like, if you want to have the interactions of the standard model, then in the Nocinus sector, there must necessarily be a left-handed right, a left-right asymmetry.
Interesting. So you don't derive chirality. You have to assume it. Once you assume it, you get the standard model gauge group?
Yes, yeah, so some are chiralities built into the vacuum, how our vacuum looks like. I mean, as I said, as soon as you work with Dirac spinners, I mean, there's this left and right components. You can write it as a pair of Weyl spinners, and then you have chirality right away.
Now, there's many different tributaries that we can go down. So one of them is about baryogenesis, which is just this large unsolved problem in cosmology. Why are we here? Why aren't mm-hmm. we just a sea of photons or something else? So please explain what baryogenesis is and what is the mechanism from which it emerges in your theory?
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm happy that you ask that. Well, I mean, first of all, baryogenesis in general, the question is, why is there more matter than antimatter? I mean, if you look out in the stars, I mean, they are all formed of matter. I mean, you can produce antimatter in the lab and also some cosmic radiation. There's also some antimatter there. But still, there's a large abundance of matter compared to antimatter. And the question is, how does this, why? What is the reason for that? And most physicists believe that right after the Big Bang, there was a symmetry between matter and antimatter. In other words, or in my picture, I mean, you had this completely filled Dirac seas, so you have neither matter nor antimatter.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Dirac equation explains pair creation. I mean, as I indicated earlier, you take out a state from the sea and you bring it into a state of positive energy. This creates pairs, but there is no way you could create matter without creating antimatter. So then the question is, why? How did this matter-antimatter asymmetry, how does this come up? So did this emerge? I mean, let's say, was this created dynamically? This is what most people believe in. And then how? And as I said, I mean, the Dirac equation by itself cannot explain that. Well, and then our mechanism, I mean, there are explanations which work, use quantum field theory concepts. And so I would say there are already possible explanations for baryogenesis, but there's no consensus on what the correct mechanism should be. And causal Fermat system now gives a different proposal for baryogenesis. And the idea is, at least on a non-technical level, I mean, it's quite simple. I mean, as I said, I mean, we take this Dirac picture seriously. So this means mm-hmm. at the beginning, suppose we have a completely filled Dirac. Now the system evolves. And I'm really thinking of evolving starting from the Big Bang. So right after the Big Bang, you have this completely filled Dirac. Now the system evolves in time, and then there is inflation and structure formation. I mean, many different things happen. And the idea is, as a consequence of that, at a later point, you need fewer states to form the Dirac. And then there are states left over, so to speak, and they then occupy positive energy solutions, and this is the matter we observe. So this is the whatever simple intuitive idea behind this. Now, if you want to describe this more concretely, then one has to derive corrections to the Dirac equation. I mean, as I mentioned earlier, I mean, the Dirac equation allows for pair creation, but it does not allow for the creation of particles without antiparticles. So therefore, we have to go beyond the Dirac equation. And this is something we can do because we have this causal action principle and the corresponding order Lagrange equations.
Uh-huh.
So what we do is that we derive corrections to the Dirac equation coming from this causal action principle. And then these corrections, they allow for baryogenesis. And this is then what we analyze. And this is, I realized I started this with Claudio Paganini, I mean, this postdoc of mine who I mentioned earlier. In fact, he had the idea. I mean, we had here summer school, when was it? 2018, I think. Yes, I mean, he was one of the participants of the summer school. And after the summer school, he told me, well, have you thought about baryogenesis? And then this is then how we started thinking about that.
Huh.
More recently, I also worked this out together with a graduate student of mine, so Marco van den Belt-Serrano. So this means we worked this out also on a technical level. So mathematically, it's kind of clear how this mechanism works.
And there is something called the Sakharov conditions. I'm unsure. Are you accepting the Sakharov conditions?
Yeah, mm-hmm, yeah.
Because it requires a C and a CP violation. I don't know where the CP violation would enter in your formalism.
Yeah, this is also something good question. I mean, this is also something we analyzed in our paper, and it seems that our mechanism is compatible with these Sakharov criteria.
Uh-huh.
So the next step for us is to work this out more quantitatively. So, and what we need is, I mean, how was the metric in the early universe, for example? And then once we have the metric, depending on time, then we can compute, at least in principle, I mean, the rate of baryogenesis. So this is something I would like to do in the near future. Also, I talked with a few physicists already. And, it's not quite so easy, first of all, to find a common language. And also, well, in cosmology, there are many unknowns, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who knows how the metric looked like right after the Big Bang? I mean, this is nothing we can observe directly. So this is why there are models, but they are quite sophisticated. They involve many parameters. And this is why we are still trying to get into this. And hopefully we can really compute how big is our baryogenesis rate and does it match up with observations? How does it relate to other baryogenesis mechanisms and so on?
Now, your causal action has only a single parameter that's free, the kappa parameter.
Mm-hmm.
Is this supposed to somehow give rise to the 25 or so different parameters in the standard model, as well as this baryogenesis factor? Or does that come from the configuration of the Dirac-C? Like, is it somewhere else?
Yeah, okay, yeah, good question. I mean, of course, I mean, you're right. I mean, on the fundamental level in this causal action, there is just one parameter kappa, because all the others you can kind of scale away. I mean, there's just one scale-free parameter, and this parameter kind of tells you about, at least it's related to kind of the ratio of the Planck length to the Compton length. I mean, this is a very small dimensionless parameter, and this parameter is determined by kappa and vice versa. Good. And then, of course, if you have one parameter, you would say, well, great. This means I just have one parameter. I can compute all the other parameters on physics. Unfortunately, this is not how it is, at least not at the moment, because, well, we have to model the vacuum configuration. So we have to say, how does the vacuum configuration look like? And then we have to say, well, there are different Dirac-Cs, and then three parameters come into play. First of all, each Dirac-C comes with a mass. So then you have like three masses, and we have the three neutrino masses as additional three parameters. And then there are, at least at the moment, parameters which come from the fact that we need to regularize the system. I mean, this is also something I should have mentioned. I mean, this causal Fermi system approach, the idea is that, well, first of all, we have our space-time continuum description. This is something which should not hold on all length scales. If you suppose you zoomed in to tiny length scales, at some point you see that space-time is discrete, for example. So there's a certain minimal length scale which comes into play, which you can think of as the Planck length. And then this is typically put in by regularizing the system. So you smear out all the objects on a certain length scale, which we call epsilon, and which you can think of as the Planck length. And then only these regularized objects are the physical objects.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we don't know how space-time looks like on the Planck scale. So therefore, this regularization procedure also involves a number of free parameters. And in fact, at the moment, quite many. I mean, simply because we don't know how space-time looks like on the Planck scale.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.